Welcome to a video that will show you how to determine the real zeros of a polynomial on the graphing calculator. Let's start with a quick review. If f is a function and x is a real number such that f of x equals 0, then x is a real zero of f. And secondly, even though a polynomial function of degree n has n complex zeros, provided multiple zeros are counted, we are only able to determine the real zeros of a function by analyzing the graph. If a function has complex zeros, we will have to use additional techniques to determine those zeros. Graphically, if we want to find the real zeros of this polynomial function, or the values of x that make the function equal to 0, those would be the x-intercepts of the function. So let's go ahead and take a look at the graph of this function. I've already typed in the function. Let's go ahead and press zoom 6 to make sure we have the standard window. And notice that we do have 3 x-intercepts, and therefore we do have 3 real zeros for this polynomial function. Let's go ahead and use the calculator to determine these zeros, which are sometimes called the roots of the function as well. So we'll press second, trace, then option 2 for 0. The next thing we have to do is determine which zero we want to find, because it can only find one at a time. Let's go ahead and find the zero on the left first. Right now the cursor is at the point 0, 30, so it's way up here off the screen, and the calculator is asking for the left bound. So we need to move the cursor until it's left of this point here, which in this case would mean below this zero. So let's press the left arrow until we see the cursor come into view. Here it is. And we want it to be left, which in this case would be below. So we'll press left arrow one more time, press enter. Now it's asking for the right bound. So we need to be to the right of this point here. So we'll press the right arrow once, and notice that we are slightly above or to the right of that zero. So we'll press enter again, and then enter again. And you can see the zero is x equals negative 3. And we can also see that the function value is 0. So let's go ahead and record that on our screen. One of the zeros is x equals negative 3. Notice on the right, we can determine these x-intercepts just by looking. It looks like x equals 2 and x equals 5. Instead of using this 0 feature on the calculator, let's go ahead and use the t-table this time. If we press second graph, and let's go ahead and make sure our table is in ask mode. So we'll press second window and make sure your independent variable is on ask. If it's not, just go down, highlight it, and press enter. And now we'll go back to our table. And we thought we had a 0 at 2. This verifies we do, because the function value is 0. We also thought we had 1 at 5. And looks like we do. So let's go ahead and record those as well. One last connection I'd like to make is, if these are the zeros of this function, this should help us rewrite this in factored form if we wanted to. What I mean by that is, if x equals negative 3 is a zero of this function, then x plus 3 would have to be a factor of this cubic. And if x equals 2 is a zero, then x minus 2 would be a factor. And if x equals 5 is a 0, then x minus 5 would be a factor. And again, we can verify that, because if we substitute these values into this function in factored form, it would be equal to 0. Let's go ahead and try another one. Notice now we have a degree 4 polynomial, so we will have 4 complex zeros, but we may or may not have 4 real zeros. Let's go ahead and press y equals and type in our new function. Go ahead and press graph. Let's go ahead and adjust our window a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and decrease the x maximum and increase the x minimum so that it spreads the graph out a little bit. So I'm going to change this to negative 5 to the left and positive 5 to the right. Press graph. And it kind of spreads it out a little bit. Now notice that on the left side here we have an x-intercept, but the graph just touches the x-axis and then rebounds or turns. And what that means is that this x-intercept, or this 0, would have multiplicity 2, or it would be a double 0, because since it's degree 4, this is a real 0, this is a real 0, that leaves 2, But because of the way the graph behaves, we know this would be a double zero. So it looks like all of the zeros here are also real. So let's press second, trace, option two. Let's go ahead and find the zero on the left first. So we'll press the left arrow until we're to the left of that zero. Maybe somewhere over here. Press enter, and now we're going to move to the right. Press enter, and then enter one more time. And the calculator's a little bit off, but we can see that this would be x equals negative 2, which makes the function equal to 0. Let's go ahead and record that 0. We'll say x equals negative 2, and we'll say this has a multiplicity of 2. Let's go ahead and find the remaining two zeros. And we can see by inspection that this 0 is 1 and this 0 is 3. Let's go ahead and verify that on the table. X equals 1 produces a function value of 0, and so does 3. So let's go ahead and record those two, 1 and 3. And again, just to make the connection, these real zeros do help us rewrite this in factored form if we wanted to. Now, if x equals negative 2 is a 0, that means x plus 2 would be a factor. But this would be a double factor since this did have multiplicity of 2, so we could write x plus 2 squared times, if we have a 0 of 1, x minus 1 would be a factor. And if we have a 0 of 3, x minus 3 would be a factor. All of these values of x would make this function equal to 0, and it's much easier to see in factored form. Let's go ahead and take a look at one more. Let's start by looking at the graph of this function. So we have x cubed minus 2x squared plus 9x minus 18. Press graph. Now notice I adjusted the window, so I'm going to go ahead and press zoom 6 to get back to the standard window. And notice on this graph, we only see one x-intercept, therefore we're going to anticipate only one real zero for this polynomial function. Looks like it's going to be x equals 2. Let's go ahead and verify that. Second trace, option 2. Now the cursor is at x equals 0, so I'm going to hit the right arrow this time until it comes into view. Now I am left of this 0, so I'm going to press enter. Now it's asking for us to go to the right side, so in this case it'll be above. Let's press enter, and press enter one more time. So one of the zeros is x equals 2. Let's go ahead and record that. Remember, what that tells us is that one of the factors of this function is x minus 2. So this function would be equal to x minus 2 times some quadratic. And since there was only one real zero, that means the other two are going to be complex zeros. So what we can do is take this original function and divide it by x minus 2. And let's go ahead and do that so that we can find the complex zeros as well. So again, because we know that x minus 2 is a factor of this cubic, we're going to take this cubic and divide it by x minus 2. Let's go ahead and do that division on the next screen. And I'm going to go ahead and use synthetic division for this problem. So we'll have r equals 2, and we'll go ahead and write out the coefficients of this polynomial. That would be 1, negative 2, 9, and negative 18. So remember, we bring the first number down. Multiply by r, so 2 times 1 would be 2. We add, that would be 0. 2 times 0 would be 0. We add down, that would be 9. And then 2 times 9 would be 18. We have a remainder of 0, which is good because that tells us that x minus 2 was indeed a factor of this cubic. So when we take a degree 3 and divide by a degree 1 polynomial, the result will be a degree 2. So this represents 1x squared plus 0x plus 9. This would be our quotient. Let's take this back to the previous screen. So this cubic is equal to x minus 2 times a quadratic x squared plus 9. So to find the remaining two zeros, what we can do now is set x squared plus 9 equal to 0 and solve, since we already know that x equals 2 is a 0 from this factor. So let's go ahead and subtract 9 on both sides. Take the square root of both sides. We have x equals plus or minus 3i. And those are the two complex zeros of this function. So these two plus this real one give us the three complex zeros that we expect. Okay, that's going to do it for this video. I hope you found it helpful.